All this is gold. Okay, this is the point of hypothesis testing. This is the claim. This is the parameter that claim is about. It's about a proportion. The majority is about a proportion. And it's also about a population. Is this an easy claim to know whether it's true or not? Like, definitively know that?
No.
No. Just like parameters are not easy to know. You know, anything that involves a large group of people is hard to know. What we're going to do is look at the evidence for or against this claim. Just like in a courtroom, you never really know whether somebody is innocent. You just know whether there was enough evidence to say they were guilty or not. We're trying to evaluate this claim. We're going to be looking at evidence. One thing that we're going to do is think about what this means in symbols. Because we're talking about a majority, that's talking about, is the proportion of all the CCD students that own a dog more than 50%? Anything above 50%, when you say something has a majority, that's what you mean. That's going to be important because there's a lot of symbols involved in looking at the evidence and weighing the evidence. And we're going to kind of translate English, this sentence, into the symbols that the formulas and the science uses. Just like with any sort of time you're talking about a proportion, you could talk about it as a percentage or as a decimal. You could say it's greater than 50%. You could say P is greater than 0.5. Same thing, just like with a probability. You want to test this claim. You could just do the non-scientific thing and pull some answer out of your butt. Or you could do what science tells you you should do, which is
sample.
Boom. And generally, the more people you sample, the better. We sampled 50 students. That's not a bad sample size. And 28 of them own a dog. So this is all sample data. And another thing that's going to be important is that my sample proportion, which I could call P hat, is that 28 people out of 50, which I could write as 0.56. At this point, do we have any evidence that P is greater than 50%? So we took a sample. We got our sample proportion is greater than 50%. Does that give us any evidence at all that our population proportion is over 50%?
Yes.
Yeah, for sure. Yes, great. The whole point of a hypothesis test is, does it give us enough evidence to say that P is more than 50%? Just like in a trial, somebody's on trial for murder and somebody's like, oh, my cousin said that they did it. Well, great. There's some evidence, but is that enough evidence to convict this person of being guilty for murder? Hopefully not. What we want to know is, do we have significant evidence? And I could even say this a little bit better. Do we have statistically significant evidence? We have some evidence, but do we have enough that we're going to say that we think the majority of all CCD students own a dog? That's the goal here. So how do we do that? There's multiple ways you can do a hypothesis test. The way that I'm going to do it is called the p-value method. I think it's the most straightforward, easiest to understand method. There's a method called the critical value method. We're going to be doing the p-value method. The way that I teach the p-value method is that there are 5 steps. It's not a universal thing, these steps. Other teachers might do p-value method even slightly different than what I'm about to do. Step 1, state the hypotheses. Hypotheses is plural. There are 2 things that are included in this step: stating what's called the null hypothesis and the alternative hypothesis. And there's symbols that are associated with those. You might see the null hypothesis be given as an H with a 0 or an O down here. And then the alternative hypothesis might be given with an H with A. Your book might use a 1 down there. I think A just is more clear that this is the alternative. So the hypotheses are always about parameters. Both in the null and the alternative, we're going to see for this claim that we're wondering about a P here, because we're asking about a parameter. And the null hypothesis, null, zero, nada, zilch, it's like a statement about no effect, nothing going on here. You always see an equal sign here. And in the alternative hypothesis, you see one of 3 things: either a greater than sign, less than sign, or a not equal to sign, depending on the claim you're testing. We could have been testing if CCD students, if less than half of them own a dog. But because our claim was the majority, then what we see in our alternative is this greater than sign. So the alternative hypothesis is where you always state the claim in symbols. So because our claim was do more than 50% of people own a dog, our alternative hypothesis is P is more than 50%. The null hypothesis has a number in it as well, which is the same number. If I have 50% in my alternative in my claim, then my null is that P is equal to 50%. So this number right here has a symbol that we'll use. It's P naught. We'll be doing some math related to formulas that have P naught in them, and P naught is just the number. We could have asked, do more than 40% of CCD students own a dog? And P naught would have been 40%. So that's stating the hypotheses. Sometimes you might see them called the formal hypotheses. Fantastic. Okay. So that's step one. Step two is where we're going to start evaluating our claim, getting to what the data tells us about our claim. Calculate the test statistic. You calculate the test statistic using the data and the hypotheses. So because we're doing a hypothesis test for a population proportion, our test statistic looks like this. It is a z-score, which means that eventually the standard normal distribution is going to come into effect. And the formula for that z-score is, what does this tell us? The interpretation of it, that tells you how many standard deviations our result is from what we expect. This is a big if I'm about to give, if the null is true. Just as a reminder, we had for our data, we had a sample proportion, a p-hat of 0.56, p-naught, the number we were comparing our parameter to of 0.5, and we had a sample size of 50. So we can slam all these numbers into this formula. We end up with, for this particular problem, our test statistic is 0.849. So we've got our test statistic. What the heck was the point of that? We're still doing this process of talking about what the data is telling us. So the next step in this p-value method is to actually do the thing called find the p-value. And because we're doing a hypothesis test for a population proportion, p-value is an area under a standard normal distribution that has a mean of 0 and a standard deviation of 1. So fine, we have to find an area under the standard normal distribution. How do we know which area to find? The two things that we have to use in order to figure out what area we need are the test statistic that we just found and the alternative hypothesis, which is basically the claim that we're trying to test. So let's just look at what that looks like. For me, this is a visual thing. I always draw pictures of this. So for our example, our p-value, here I've got, this is a standard normal distribution, and here's our test statistic sitting right here. It's 0.849. And our p-value happens to be the area to the right of it. And why that is the p-value corresponds to the alternative hypothesis. So because our alternative was greater than, so our p-value is the greater than area, the area to the right of our test statistic and a standard normal distribution. How do we find this area? To find the p-value, we're going to use normal CDF. So when we do that, we get the p-value. If I want to write it in symbols, I could say it's the proportion of z-scores that are above 0.849. It's the probability of getting a z-score more than 849. What is that? Yeah, question?
Why is the upper 1,000?
Because the upper is where do you want to stop calculating this area at? And 1,000 is going to be super precise.
We don't use the 1E99.
You just need a big number. You could use 1E99. You could experiment with it. You could use 10 in this case, and you would get just about the exact same answer. I tend to find 1,000 is a good balance of a number that's big enough in most cases. And what do we get for our p-value here?
0.1979.
Yeah, perfect. Pop quiz, can the p-value ever be negative? The p-value is an area under a normal distribution. Can that ever be negative? No. Follow-up question. Can the test statistic ever be negative?
Yes.
Yeah, the test statistic can. So here's our p-value. It's 0.1979. So we've done the p-value step. And just to kind of show you what else could possibly happen ever in a hypothesis test, I said that your p-value corresponds to the alternative hypothesis. And what this would look like for this problem, if our alternative hypothesis happened to be less than the p-value is just the less than area. If our claim had been the proportion less than 50%, the one that's a little bit weird is the two-sided p-value. It's possible that we would have wanted to know, hey, is the proportion of CCD students that own a dog different, not equal to 50%? And that gets referred to sometimes as a two-sided test because when you have a not equal to alternative hypothesis, your p-value, and this is a horrible picture, I should have had a perfectly symmetrical thing with the same amount of area on the outsides, and our p-value is the total area of both of these outsides. If we had this not equal to, our p-value would have been twice this number, which is 0.3958. But we weren't doing a two-sided test. We were doing the greater than test, and our p-value wasn't 0.3958. It was 0.1979. There are three possible cases for finding a p-value, the less than, the more than, and the two-sided. We're going to move on then. We've got our p-value. What is that for? The p-value is the evidence against, this is kind of weird, it's the evidence against the null in favor of the alternative. The smaller the p-value, the more evidence we have against the null. It's basically how rare was our result if the null is true, and if our result is really rare, then we think the null isn't true. So what we do with the p-value is we're going to be talking about whether we think our claim is true or not. Here's an idea. The smaller the p-value, the more evidence against the null. And then there's the question of, well, how much is enough? How much is enough evidence that we're going to say we think the null is not actually true? And that's where step four comes in. We'll make the decision. The p-value is like the trial. We've shown the evidence. The jury goes back. And now the jury comes out and they make the decision. And for a hypothesis test, the decision is always either one of these two phrases. Either we reject the null hypothesis or we don't reject the null hypothesis. The book describes this as fail to reject the null hypothesis. We're either going to do one of these two things. And which one do we do? We take our p-value and we compare it to something that's called the alpha level. The alpha level is basically how much evidence we need. And you might see it described as the level of significance. One reason why stat is kind of confusing is we have a lot of ways to describe the same exact thing. You also might see it instead of the word alpha. This fish is alpha, so you might see that as well. But there is a standard, and if they don't give you one, use 5% for the alpha level. So we're going to compare the p-value to an alpha level, and in this problem, we're going to use 5%. So what happens is that if your p-value is low enough, if it's less than alpha, you have enough evidence that the null isn't true and you reject the null hypothesis. And if your p-value is more than alpha, then your decision is to not reject the null hypothesis.
Can it ever be equal to alpha?
It certainly can. It is possible. That's a really good question, James. I think that should go here. If your p-value is exactly equal to your alpha level, you're not a very happy camper because you're right on the borderline between something that should be significant and not. You'll notice there's a little bit of weirdness here. We're just making this cutoff for at this point, it's significant, and anything different from that, it's not significant. And I'm not going to get into why that's an issue, but you might think that, hey, it is an issue, and it actually is an issue, but whatever. We're making our decision. Reject or don't reject. We're going to use a 5% alpha level. What's our decision going to be then? Our p-value was 0.1979. What's our decision going to be?
Do not reject it.
Yeah, exactly. The p-value is bigger than the significance level. So our decision is going to be do not reject the null hypothesis. To keep going with this fabulous courtroom analogy, this is like a not guilty verdict. You never accept null hypothesis. That would be like saying somebody's innocent, and a courtroom never says that they're innocent. We don't ever know whether the null hypothesis is true or not. All we know is how much evidence there is against it. A courtroom doesn't say that you actually didn't do it. That kind of language starts to get weird, but it's how a legal system works, and it's how a hypothesis test works. So we're not rejecting. That's step four. Step five is we're going to state the conclusion. We're going to describe what happened. We're going to report about our claim in a manner that is not technical. We're not going to use phrases like reject, fail to reject. We're just going to say, in this case, what does our data tell us about the proportion of CCD students that own a dog? If you think about our claim here that the majority of CCD students own a dog, and what happens is we don't have enough evidence that that's true. We're going to state that we don't have enough evidence that it's true. Our conclusion is going to look like this. We're going to say, based on our data, because it's important to sort of understand, I think it's important, that all of this is based on our data. And if we had different data, we might have come to a different conclusion. But based on our data, do not have, a lot of times you don't see the word statistically in there, but I'm going to put it in there. We don't have statistically significant evidence that, and you always talk about the alternative. So we don't have statistically significant evidence for this, that the majority of CCD students own a dog. So when you fail to reject, you just talk about not having enough evidence for your claim. What do you think we would have said if we had rejected, if we had ended up with a small p-value?
How would we? Data, we do have statistically significant evidence that the majority of CCD students own a dog.
Exactly. You really only need to get rid of that word not. Rejecting means, hey, you're out of here. We're getting rid of the null. We rejected it. I'm not going to write out the whole thing, but you just would need to say we do have evidence. Rejecting is like the guilty verdict. Do we know whether we made the right decision with 100% certainty or not? No. Great. That's another big deal thing with statistics. No, we don't. Because we don't know the proportion of CCD students that own a dog. We're never going to know that. We're going to do our best to talk about that, just like a confidence interval does. And according to the data that we have, the best thing that we can say is that we don't have evidence currently. We could be wrong. It turns out that mathematically, it's more likely than not that we're right, but there's a chance that we could be wrong. But that's the process of a hypothesis test, taking the data, collecting the evidence in terms of the p-value, using the p-value to decide whether you think your claim is true or you don't have enough evidence that your claim is true. And just like a courtroom could say an innocent person is guilty and a guilty person is innocent, analysis of the ways that you can go wrong, I think, are important. Well, great. Well, that's all I wanted to say. Thanks for showing up. If you have any questions, obviously, feel free to email me.